the immediate past president, and
I'm out of leadership.
But she served on the president of the Association of Avian Veterinarians. If I slow down, I can do this. Served as chairperson on the AAV Research Committee, vice president of the Association of Exotic Mammal Veterinarians, and also served on their boards. She is the recipient of a 2011 and 2012 President's Award from the AAV for outstanding service, the 2008 recipient of the AEMV President's Award, and has numerous other professional honors and awards. Dr. Powers has written more than 30 scientific journals, articles, and book chapters, and has lectured extensively in the U.S. and abroad. But last year you spoke in Australia as a keynote speaker. And I can't say how fortunate we are that we have Dr. Powers in our back door. We lovingly call her the Dalai Lama of Avian. And so, and it's just such a pleasure to introduce you. So let's give her a look.
A lot of faces I recognize here today. You may see some pictures in here that you might recognize. So just be prepared to keep a lookout for that. I have about an hour's worth of material to present. So if you guys have no questions or no comments, we would finish in about an hour. But I'm pretty much open to whatever you guys want to do. Panthers kickoff is at 4 o'clock. Charlotte, which is over on South Tryon near the airport, and Carowinds over there. And then there's Matthews, which is in Stallings, not too far from here. And then there's Rock Hill. And so I work pretty much every day, 4 days a week, 10 hours a day, scheduled appointments in Huntersville. We're off duty on Thursdays. Once a month, we see patients in our Matthews location. We were there 2 days ago, for example. So, and we're trying to fill a need for our clients in.
That's Canadian.
Thank you.
depending on questions, yes.
You're the boss.
I do want to cover the material, so if I cut you off, it's not on purpose. It's not that I don't like you or anything. It's just that we need to kind of keep focused on the content. So I don't take it personally, but hopefully I will offend you. So today I want to talk about avian health and wellness from that avian medical perspective. And the way I put this together is kind of like what avian meds really want you to know or wish you knew. Opportunity to give you information that we share every day to the clients that are coming in, and we're trying to educate people in advance and working with organizations like parrot universities and VR to help with. So I thought I would try to categorize it into a few sections that we're going to talk about. Basically, stuff you can do at home and stuff you can do with a vet. Does this have a laser pointer?
It's missing the bulb. To the right.
This is the stuff that you can do at home, and this is the stuff that you can do working with your vet. So preventative care and healthcare at home. I'm going to talk very briefly about diet and exercise and lighting and life cycles, and then things you can do for wellness. Health is basically a physical state of being where there's not clinical illness or disease. That's the state of health. Well-being.
Fun food
workshop. And then what is that, a workshop or a class?
It's a workshop.
And then you have classes too, right?
Parrot 101, and then Avian Health and Wellness. And then we have toy making also.
Toy making. So I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this, but we do get a lot of questions as avian vets about diet. And a lot of times if a bird is sick, the first place people are thinking about is the food, which isn't always the case. But the basic categories of food types that we feed to our pet birds are formulated diets, fresh foods, and then dry goods like seeds, nuts, grains, and cereals. So formulated diets are basically something that we designed and we put together. I'll be honest with you, the vast majority of the formulated diets that we have available are basically designed after poultry diets, because chickens are granivorous and many of our citizen birds are also granivorous, and when we didn't have anything else, that's where we started from. So a lot of the formulated diets are based on that. Some changes, you know, some changes have been made to the sugar content, the fat content, the appearance of the diet, different sizes, shapes, colors, textures, flavors, that sort of thing. But they have a lot of similarities in common with each other, and we don't have a lot of evidence-based information on diets, which diets are best for what species or what clinical condition. So we need to learn a lot more about this. There's two main kinds of nuggets. There's pellets and extruded diets. And even though we call them pellets, honestly, the majority of these nugget kind of diets are actually extruded diets, which are generated under high heat and then pressure, a pressurized process to get them into that appearance. Pellets are not put so much under that high heat, but they're much more difficult to make, to keep together without that process. Then there's things called blended diets, which are diets that are made together with some sort of dry bone usually, and then a formulated diet. So like your Nutriberries and your Avicakes from Lefavors, those are blended diets. If you break them apart, they'll have little seeds and then the little pellets. They call that a blended diet. So we actually recommend about 70, maybe 80% of the diet be a formulated diet for most citrus seed bird species, not all, but most citrus seed birds. suggestions based on someone's experience or someone's opinion. That's kind of where we are on the level of evidence right now. And so the recommendations I may be making may be completely different than from what someone else makes. And that's okay, because we don't really have a lot of information. And so what I recommend versus what you are doing, what if what you're doing is different than what I'm saying, that's still perfectly fine. And I don't know if the recommendations that I'm talking about here today are in line with what you guys are saying here. You may have different recommendations based on new information that's coming out on diets. But so I want to just say that anything I say here in terms of enrichment and diet is not necessarily set in stone. You don't have to eat exactly 70% pellets to your gray parrot. But it's just a rough guideline, so just a rough start. Does anyone have any questions about that? Yes?
I thought that it was proven that if you're the high in fat, like the seeds and that kind of thing, if it's too much, they'll end up with fatty liver.
Yes, there is some evidence to say that high-fat diets can induce certain kinds of disease states in birds, but not a lot of citizen birds. We're getting some more information. Like, if you feed a diet that consists of, like, there are strains of pigeons and chickens that are genetically susceptible to atherosclerosis, which is a cardiovascular disease. But if you feed them a low-cholesterol diet, they don't typically get that disease. But if you feed them a diet that's 1% cholesterol or higher, that will induce the disease in those birds. We've seen that also in Quaker parakeets, monk parakeets. Mm-hmm. So we're starting to get some information, but we make a lot of assumptions about diet and recommendations in birds. It is probably true that feeding a high-fat, high-carbohydrate diet to a parakeet will quite possibly expose it to fat metabolism diseases, such as obesity, lipomas, which are fatty growths under the skin, chronic liver disease, cardiovascular disease like atherosclerosis. These are the kinds of diseases that we see with fat metabolism disorders, which are not necessarily the disorders of the bird, and they might be disorders about the way we are feeding them and how they are living in our homes. Yeah, it's a good point. Because a lot of seeds, especially domestic seeds that are farmed, that we've developed and designed to be consumed in our society, are high in fat. Not all the seeds and nuts and grains and cereals that are sourced from their origins are that high in fat. But it's also a really good idea to feed birds fresh whole foods. These would be fruits and vegetables, for example, and this is where these guys really play a huge role, is to help you figure out how to get that into your bird's diet, because not all birds are going to accept that right away, and it can take a lot of work and effort to get a bird to accept fresh foods, but they are great for enrichment, for balancing out the nutrition, and they're an excellent source, many of them are an excellent source of fiber, antioxidants, and vitamins. Seeds and nuts, sunflower seeds have absolutely no vitamin A, no beta carotene in them whatsoever. Even if some company who sprays the outside of the shell with a vitamin mixture, that's going to drop to the floor of the kitchen. Not going to eat that. And so birds that selectively eat just seeds and nuts are going to be deficient in vitamin A. But dark green leafy vegetables and red orange vegetables that are rich in beta carotene, which is turned into vitamin A in the body, for example. So giving fresh foods is one way to round out that diet and give them that food nutrition. You can give them the whole food item, like you can cut up wheels of corn on the cob, and always wash your raw food, right? Because this is food that's been sitting in the dirt with manure in it, right? So you want to wash every fruit, vegetable that you feed. But you can feed it whole, or you can feed it in a chop or a mash, and that's one of the great things about the courses they teach here. They teach you how to put those together, how to put those together, how to store them, how to feed them, how to get your birds to take them. And there's excellent online resources too as well. Last year, you guys had Dr. Jason Green come, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many of you guys were able to attend his lectures? Oh, gosh. He has a closed Facebook page, is that right? Avian Whole Foods or something like that?
Yes.
Avian Raw Nutrition.
Avian Raw Nutrition. Which is an excellent resource, because it's really, just kind of a support group for people with ideas about what kind of whole foods you can feed, new ideas about what works, what you can try, just really kind of support. that birds are selective foragers, so they're going to pick out the food that tastes good. And I think this is one of the reasons why we get along so well with them, is because they have similar tastes. I like pizza. Know what their weights are, then you know some birds we've seen for years, and their weights go up and down. They fluctuate quite a bit. Other birds are rock steady, and you know what their weights are. And if they start to tick down, there might be a problem. The birds might start losing weight before they show any other signs of illness, and you catch something more quickly. I get this question a lot. What my bird weighs 472 grams. Is that good? Is that normal? Like, I won't know until I examine the bird, because people come in different body types and sizes. What's normal for some, a little tall person might weigh 200 pounds, and that might be normal for them, but someone who's 5'1", 200 pounds is going to be probably overweight for them. So, it really depends on their body size. There's a lot of variation out there. So we look oftentimes at the body condition score, so you feel them over the chest. And I didn't put numbers here because people use different numbering scales. I use a 1 to 5.
Use a 6.
Six?
Yeah.
Six to
6 to 9? Because usually.
Nine.
Yeah.
Nine.
One of us reads the records at least. I'm just kidding. Touche.
Sharp as a knife. We make jokes about that. It's not so funny, but this would be like a 1
Quail? Quail? Oh, it's a Bob White? No, that would... Yay.
Oh, Brian?
Brian, yeah.
Oh, wow.
But he didn't like it. The only reason, the only way he would play on this is if there was potato chips in the bottom. That's the only way I can get him to play that. not environmentally friendly. I realize that, but it's relatively inexpensive, so it's something that's in my budget. And there's better options out there. But I put this together for like $100, maybe. Mm-hmm. You know, and it can disassemble, so you can like store it and that sort of thing. Activity is also great for enrichment. I can show you the video. Let me see if I can show you the video. It's going to take a little while, though. Now we can go. Do you want to see the video?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yeah. Sure. Let's see if I can get that up. Let's see. Oh, I'm going to try not to look on the screen. Yeah. So dancing. And nobody will think you look stupid if you dance with your bird, right? Because you can't look at your bird, right? Not dancing yourself. Lighting and light cycles. I think we're still in our infancy in understanding what our companion birds really need in our homes. But they do need adequate lighting. You can't obviously keep a parrot in the basement, right? And that would not be appropriate. You want to have a pretty reasonable amount of ambient light for them. There's a lot of questions about exposure to ultraviolet light, and I think that's something that we still need to learn more about. There is some evidence that some species of birds may benefit from exposure to UVB. So UVB, do you guys all know about ultraviolet light? Raise your hands if you want to talk about it. Okay, just a little bit. Okay. So ultraviolet light, so here's a spectrum of light, and here's visible light down here, kind of in the yellow and red and blue. But over here are your ultraviolet light spectrums, your UVA, B, and C. And so these are not in the light spectrum that we see, so most of our lights don't include ultraviolet. Plus, excessive exposure to ultraviolet light can be damaging, right, to our eyes and induce cornea, like cataracts or skin cancer and those sorts of things. So, you know, we have to be a little bit careful, but birds can actually see in the ultraviolet spectrum. And it's astounding what we've learned over the last, like, 10 years or so, that a lot of these birds, actually, their plumage reflects ultraviolet light, and birds can see that. And we can't see it, but you know how we say, oh, birds are monomorphic? That's because we can't, by looking at them, tell the difference between males and females. But I bet you there are many species out there that they can, instantly, because they can see in the ultraviolet spectrum. And so a lot of birds fluoresce ultraviolet light, because this is a budgerigar, and I have to say it the correct way, because it's in Australia. It's not a budgerigar, it's a budgerigar. And so this is the way it would look with visible light, the way we are accustomed to seeing. But this is the way it would look with ultraviolet capturing. So these feathers around its head and its cheeks actually reflect ultraviolet light. And so birds can see that, and they can detect that.
And here's another cool one.
This is, you guys, there's some people in this room going to do this.
Wow.
What is it?
White belly kite.
Yeah, white belly kite, as opposed to the other common species,
black cat.
Yeah. So this is what they look like to us, visible light. This is what they look like when they pick up the reflected ultraviolet light. Their head, you know, basically is just brilliantly colored when you capture the ultraviolet spectrum. So this probably has a lot to do with foraging, you know, looking for, you know, bright flowers and that sort of thing, and also communication amongst each other. So one of the things about light is that tempered glass and plexiglass filter out over 90% of ultraviolet B. And some people don't realize that. That's especially important for what other animals besides birds?
Humans.
Reptiles, right?
Humans.
Much, because we could thing that's true is that if you then go back and give these biggest turkeys lichen, cancer will often come back. Mm-hmm.
So it just becomes dormant.
Yeah, but
which makes sense because when you open up someone with cancer, it spreads. Like the light.
Yeah, so it's a lesson that the photoperiod, the lighting, has a dramatic influence on the bird's pineal gland and, you know, brain sex hormones and circulating sex hormones and it's just an extreme example of that. So, you know, and I know also birds that for people who work third shift and they really want to hang out with their birds, so they come home and, what time they come home? They come home at
7 a.m.
Yeah, and they sleep all day, right? And then and then awake during the night, and they want to interact with their birds. So the known people have actually kept their birds up at like 11, 12, 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. And that's not a normal situation. I've actually seen birds start to damage their feathers, chew and pluck their feathers when the people they live with shifted from a first or second shift to third shift. That's not natural. That's the only video that I have of bathing. I typically sneak into people's homes and take pictures of it. But bathing, you can say that, people say, how often should I bathe my bird? As if I have the answer to that question. It's like, oh, you must do it, every 7 to 10 days. Birds could probably be perfectly healthy and never bathe. Some birds are fearful of water. Not want to force that on them, so it can be extremely detrimental to them. So it's probably okay for birds that are fearful of water not to bathe. I was just working on that because bathing is really great for overall skin and plumage health. It can get rid of dander. And my military macaw Milo, he kind of looks a little ruffled, but after I spray him down and he breathes that off, he looks so handsome. He looks so beautiful. So it stimulates natural grooming behavior. And it's really great for the skin and the plumage. It's great for enrichment. It's great for them to feel like they're doing the natural behavior for them. There's different methods that you can do, and I'm sure these guys here talk about it. Do you guys talk about bathing in Parrot 101?
Yeah.
So you can mist or spray them, and for this you just you can fill up a squirt bottle. One that's never had any cleaning chemicals in it, right? Just brand new, and you fill it up with warm water. And you can mist it, the finest mist, and you can mist it up and let that mist fall down. So if birds are accustomed to being sprayed or misted, it's a less stressful, less traumatic way for a bird to get accustomed to being sprayed or misted. Some birds are like spraying and just blasting them, and they're the cockatiels. Have you seen this? Where they're like, love the birds. Sometimes get so excited they fall off the perch. They get so happy. You can also give them shallow dishes and bowls. I know, Anna, you do this, right?
Yes.
You give parakeets, little parakeets will come. Mine don't do this, but hers do. You put a shallow water dish in.
And parsley.
And, oh, they love to bathe in parsley.
Yes.
And bunnies love to bathe in vegetables. so you can lightly miss that. They get down and they have a good time with that. Or some birds really like it in the sink, right? You turn the sink on, mm-hmm. and they'll come over and they'll get under the water and make a big mess out of your kitchen. And a lot of birds will go in the shower with you and they make shower perches. And it's so funny when people come in and they talk about what goes out of the shower. It's like, oh, usually it stays curated, which is good. All right. Wellness at home. Wellness is pretty much, on top of maintaining good health for your bird. It's going above and beyond. It's providing a bird opportunities to enrich its life, to be more like a bird, to do normal bird active behaviors, to give them a reason to do these things. So there's different kinds of enrichment. I guess I didn't talk about that. other pellets, although some people say they really like them. It's just that for me, that my bird ate color pellets and pooped colored poop and stained my carpet. My carpet is destroyed. That is the vomit. So people also have kind of pointed their fingers at some of the dyes in pellets. So there is that. But there's a really interesting study they did on Amazon parrots not too long ago, where Amazon parrots selectively picked out the larger pieces. So when given the choice between the exact same diet, but a big, large pellet and a little small one, they picked the big one every time, because they liked that, they like to hold their food while they eat it. And there's a word for that, and it's podo, or I can't remember the term of it is, but there's a scientific term for basically wanting to use your foot to hold your food to eat it. So anyone live with Amazon? Nobody here lives with Amazon? I was going to ask you guys if you've noticed that. Have you noticed that?
They also love foot toys more than some of the other birds.
They're foot toys? Yeah. Very podo, whatever the word is. they've got a foot fetish. Let's just put that. So different sizes, different, textures. Many foods can be fed raw, but other foods you have to cook them to unlock the nutrition, like sweet potatoes, for example. So you can feed them, in a mash. You could feed them finely chopped, large, coarsely chopped, boiled, raw. There's all sorts of different ways. Like my bird doesn't like vegetables. My bird doesn't like fill in the blank here. My bird doesn't like broccoli. Well, how are you feeding the broccoli? You can try fine chopped, coarse chopped. Balls on the broccoli, you can scrape those off and roll them over the table. And then parakeets, and cockatiels, which are ground foragers, they go crazy if they do that. They're just like, they want to go and check that out. So sometimes it's the way you're providing the food. So food can be fun, food can be enrichment. A tactile enrichment is basically having something that you can hold and chew and destroy. That might be the molding in your kitchen, or it might be your
carpet.
Antique furniture, carpet. Yeah, that's all tactile. Your house is a toy. What's theirs is theirs, and what's yours is theirs. And so it's just what they get that you want to destroy. That might be toys that you purchase from a pet store or from here, or puzzles, and what I call destructibles, which is your carpet and your molding. No, just like paper and cardboard and things like that they can chew up and destroy. People joke around, their kids, their favorite toys are actually the cardboard box at the toy can. And that's true for birds too. I think it's okay for birds to chew up and destroy paper and cardboard and things like that. If they're chewing it up here and it's falling to the ground, they don't care about it on the ground. But if they're chewing it up and it's falling to the ground and they go down to it on the ground and they're moving around and talking to it and building up, what are they doing then?
Nesting.
Yes, is that good or bad?
Bad.
We don't want that. For most cases, we don't want that. So if they're doing that, they're going down there and lovingly playing with the paper down there. you might have a problem with seeing an egg. I wouldn't recommend that. Visual and auditory enrichment. This is singing to them in the shower.
whoop, whoop.
Are they adorable?
No.
What's not adorable about their comments?
It's shrill screaming. And biting.
Yeah. Mine didn't like that I did my hair today. She was like, I like it when your hair's up and you look more manly. What if you take your bird outside? Do you have a recommended time, amount of time?
I don't know. What have you heard?
I mean, if they're featherless, obviously you want to be careful because they can get sunburned, as you might find out.
I've heard 20 minutes a day.
I think that's about...
Yeah.
Or a window, it doesn't necessarily come in, or a light comes in, or maybe they're just in the room, or under a...
touch on Teflon?
I put up an emergency.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Okay. All right. Is this on a good level for you guys?
Mm-hmm. What is the lowest temperature with the winter coming?
Oh, yeah, temperature for people outside. I always tell people what's comfortable for you is probably comfortable for these birds. People do keep birds outside with cooler temperatures. They seem to do okay with that. I usually say above 65. I think I made that up.
Have you seen any evidence on how that can positively, negatively affect?
Yeah, there's probably some limited information out there on grow lights, which is in the visible light spectrum, but I think there's a little bit of ultraviolet light in there. It's not as intense as a UV bulb, which has visible light, but also a certain percentage of light in that ultraviolet spectrum. I don't think it's quite as intense as some of the lights that are designed for that. But I think some people would say that the ultraviolet is not adequate in grow lights.
But it's not a deterrent, like it's not something that's going to disturb the light. Or
I don't think it's provided, you know, the night right in their face for 12 hours. And they're not too close to that light. That is because it is putting on ultraviolet light, but it's not as intense as some of the other bulbs. That's a good question. Okay. So that is it. Before I get started, quarantine. This is something that I wish I could tell people before they came in to see me. So quarantine is a really important concept in avian medicine. I can't stress it enough. And that is basically, if you have birds in your home, you're getting a new bird, no matter where it came from, I recommend, and most avian vets recommend, keeping your new bird away from your other birds for a certain period of time. And that period of time is subject to debate, but what I was taught was 45 to 60 days. That's a long time.
I find
you take your bird to the vet, we recommend that when you first get your bird, you should bring it to the vet for a wellness visit, and then probably once a year after that. And so we do recommend an initial and annual wellness exam for all the birds, big and small. Sometimes as they get older, if they have chronic conditions, we want to see if they have a problem. And what happens during the office visit? So if they've never been there, we take an initial history. So at our practice, we have a couple of forms that we ask you guys to fill out. It helps us to get to know you and your bird. And just things like what you see and what's your enclosure. And I love pictures. So if people text me or email me pictures and have them on their phone, you can show me where the bird is.
Oh, yes.
But she can get him because she's got this, she's got this, towel.
Yeah.
And so we'll pin here, so she just spins it. That's because she grabs it and she spins. So for her and for Jacqueline here and this bird here, this works. This is okay. But for a lot of people, it's not okay because the bird's out there. We can't get him. And we also risk hurting you. Because if we have to go there and grab the birds, you know, they've got their claws into your neck and in your hair, and it's just like, it's really hard to get them out. So to get your bird into our hands, it's generally going to need to involve a towel.
No problem.
Okay, this is capture, a video data. This is what we used to call all bird restraint.
So we have two classes now. We have parrot.
101.
No, we have avian behavior and training, which
yes.
is an introductory class that goes over the science of behavior. And then now there's a new class that Wendy created that's parrot problem solving, which is actually going more in depth about your issues and things that you want to work on. And those are things that can come up.
This here
know what a bird's normal was, you know, you would be 27,000 white cell count, you know, that is probably an infection. Well, it's not, it's just normal for this bird. So, of course, you know, that being said, is the lab you're using has a lot to do with that. We do our CBCs in-house. So I know I'm the one that's doing that white cell count every single time. So I can, there's more consistency with the white cell count. So yeah, so that's a really great one, get a baseline. Any other reasons why we, Avian Vets often recommend blood work during wellness visits for birds?
Look at internal organ function, so it can, if you don't know how old the bird is, it can give you a better idea as well.
What do we know about birds? They're prey species. How would that tie in?
Well, they can hide stuff.
When we brought our bird in the U, we did that in Cocoa, and it was just the new experience out of Loria, just put a bracelet on him, so you had this full gamut of what to expect and how he was and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So it was pretty great.
It's a way to pick up on certain diseases that might be finding chronic liver disease, things like that. It's just it's one other thing that you could do to check the health status of a bird, because birds are great at hiding things. They, you know, they have a bad day in the wild. They still have to get food and water. They still have to avoid predators, find a safe place to sleep. They got to tough it out. And so they're really good at hiding things. And then their metabolism is very high. So things can change really quickly with birds. So it's a way to screen them for underlying illness. It's not a catch everything. It's not a full tox screen, full infectious disease screen panel. It's basically just a biochemistry profile. We're looking at liver values, kidney values, blood sugar, proteins, and electrolytes, calcium. So that's basically what it is. That's what we're kind of looking at. And if we find an abnormality, let's say the kidney value is elevated, that's probably going to lead us to another conversation about what to do next to find out more information. Unusual for us to get a 100% diagnosis of everything that's going on based on physical and just a blood profile. But, you know, it does, if we do find abnormalities, it can steer us in the direction of like, oh, that's not normal. Maybe we should do an x-ray, or maybe we should have you come back next week and just recheck that and see what's going on. Infectious disease screening. The big one that we talk about is screening for chlamydia. I know they can go out, you know, and have a shady night. Chlamydia is a category of bacteria. It's a bacteria. And so the chlamydia that we talk about with birds is chlamydia sinensis. And it's a kind of an avian specific strain. And there's different genotypes of that. So there's A, B, C, and there's different kind of genotypes of it that are more common in different species of birds. But it's chlamydia sinensis, and it's contagious between birds and also from birds to people. So it's what we call zoonotic. A zoonotic disease is one that can be transmitted from an animal to a person. And so you can be healthy or sick and still be susceptible to getting an infection with chlamydia. It's a hard conversation to have with your spouse. Yes. So we don't see as much of this as we used to in the 80s and 90s when a lot of the birds were imported and they were put into quarantine stations by the USDA, stressed on crappy diets, not very well cared for in our homes. Now our birds are mostly domestically bred, and they're living healthier lives. So we just don't see it just as much. You probably only see like one or two cases a year of this. But it can make a bird very sick. They can be silent carriers of it. And that's one of the reasons why we want to screen them for it. Because there's a phase of the infection that can lay dormant in tissues in the body within the liver, undetected on the outside. And so the birds that are more likely to get it are birds that probably were recently infected with it. Young birds, birds that have come from places where there are large numbers of birds around that were from different places. In other words, not quarantined from each other, just saying. But any bird of any age can be infected. It's not very common. But certain places, so we recommend testing, which is a swab. And if it's positive, it means they are shedding the bacteria. And we can treat them with antibiotics, specific antibiotics, and we can actually cure them of that. So,
Sure. So any bird that's adopted from here as well, so they have to see you or a recommended vet from our list. So we don't allow anybody just to go to any veterinarian. We want them to see a veterinarian who, I think most of them see probably at least 25% exotics. People that they teach at least one avian health and wellness class here a year so that we actually have an established relationship with them. So that's the person that we're going to have you go see, whether you're going to go see them because you want to adopt a bird from us and you're taking a current bird in your home, or if you're going to board here. So they can have a thorough exam to make sure that they appear healthy on exam, and then we require that chlamydia PCR test. And that's just because you're going to be, if you're boarding in a room with other birds, then we want to keep your bird as safe as possible. So we're pretty crazy here on top of that. We also use separate cleaning utensils for every single enclosure. So our goal is to always make sure that we don't touch anything from one cage to the next. So that's why when you come in here, it feels a little bit more sterile than other facilities. So we don't have big manzanita trees with birds hanging out all over them, because we recognize that we want this bird to come in healthy and we want it to go into your home healthy whenever it leaves here. Yeah. What's the accuracy on it? Because I know a lot of them we don't do because they're not as accurate.
For what? For the other diseases?
Correct.
Well, testing for like avian polyomavirus and beaked feather virus is very accurate.
Okay.
But we just don't see those diseases as often, as commonly as we used to. And we almost never see them. We have lovebirds that will get beaked feather. They have a specific strain of circovirus. We sometimes see those still, but I can't remember the last time I saw a parrot, like a large parrot with circovirus.
Okay. We know him. I said, we know that guy.
You know that guy?
Yeah, that's Bud.
Bud.
Yeah.
Okay, Bud.
The only canary that ever came through our program.
Yeah, the point is they're gonna get caught, and then what happens is
And if you clip it too short, you're amputating that toe. So you gotta know what you're doing. You clip it too short, you tie it to the bone.
Right.
And so that is bad. That doesn't grow back. The bone doesn't grow back. And you know, have the powder. I've talked to a lot of people who are like, and they're like, yeah, we used to clip nails at home, and we don't do that anymore. We're coming to you.
It depends on your situation. So we recommend in some situations, if you've got, like, I have four kids in my house, so I would much rather have my bird in my home than have my kid open the door and she fly out the door. So it slows her down enough that we feel it's safer.
Recommend a unilateral wing clip, which is clipping one wing, because then they might as well call health.
I can show you pictures if you'd like of why you shouldn't do that.
To take your bird to the vet.
brochures about what the emergency. This one is protecting your pet birds from household dangers by the AAE. There's others out there. These are just some of the go-to ones that we have. This is an amazing first aid kit that was when you see parrot.com. This is really cool. I don't think you need everything here. There's a lot of stuff. But at the very least, I think that you should have some sort of tote or something that will contain all of this stuff. I really like this tote because this tote is big and it snaps down. You put all your stuff in there. It's waterproof, so in case you have a bacteria shoot, get wet. That's waterproof. Looks like you can fit this carrier in there, so that's awesome. You can put this carrier in there and everything else, so you've got everything in that tote to go with you. That's pretty cool. But at a bare minimum, I would have sifted powder or gel, or a very loose cornstarch or flour to stop the bleeding. And you can find this anywhere. Pet stores, we sell it at our practice, Amazon, just to have something like that in your first aid kit. And then needle nose pliers or hemostats to pull out bleeding blood feathers, which we'll talk about in just a minute. Towels, have some towels to line the cage, to pick up your bird, in the middle of the night, you have a disaster, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, even your friendliest bird might bite you if you try to grab it and put it in a carrier. So, have some sort of carrier. I really like the collapsible ones that are metal because they can slip under a small surface, a small area, and then you can screw perches or food bowls in them too. Gloves, all these things they have here, these medical supplies. I'm not sure how critical they are to have in here. These like hand sanitizer, wound cleansers, and gloves and gauze and stuff like that. That's kind of like icing on the cake. I don't think that's absolutely necessary. I mean, yes, you want to use clean technique if you're managing any wounds and try to help minimize contamination, but that doesn't typically happen right away. So, but if you want to put that kind of stuff in there, that's great. But at the very least, I would recommend. The ceramic heat emitter would be a way to keep your bird warm if it's sick and you can't get to the vet or if you have to evacuate. But you need power for this. So, what constitutes an emergency? The biggest things that we talk about are here, but there's many other things that could be constituted. This is not an all-inclusive list. But if your bird is weak, and so a bird that's weak is just wobbly and fluff. They might stay fluff, they might keep their feathers fluff. That's what birds fluff their feathers. Or sometimes they're sleepy, or sometimes their feathers quiver. But if they're staying fluffed, and even if you're moving and making loud noises, if they're staying fluffed, that's probably not normal. Or if they're too weak to be on their perch, they're maybe down on the bottom of the cage, and they're just hanging out down there, that could be a sign that there's something wrong. Poor responsiveness. So birds are prey species, and they should react when you make a sound or you make a movement. They should be on alert and see you and keep their eyes open. If they're keeping their eyes closed, even if you're making noise or moving around, that's not normal. Now I say this, but young baby birds, they're just all goofy. They're like, they'll do whatever they want. Baby birds, all these things are obvious. And then not necessarily, just because a baby bird, they're either on or off, right? So we need to take an
I can unplug if you need me to.
Rapid shot. Bird is like opening its mouth for every breath, or the wings are going in and out with each breath, and the tail is pumping up and down with each breath. That is a reason to come to the vet. This is the thing that makes me cringe the most because these birds are suffering. They're very critical. If you touch them, that might be too much for them. If you know what I mean. So we put them in oxygen right away. Blood in the droppings. You should never see that. Blood in the droppings, you should be going to the avian vet. Egg binding, female birds, they've made an egg and can't get it out. And so they're straining, they're puffy or swollen. They may have blood in the droppings, they may have tissue protruding from the vent. That's the reason you come to the vet. Sometimes you don't know, sometimes you have to have an exam. Seizures, birds can have seizures. We'll bring it to the vet if they're convulsing. Or if they have major trauma or burns. Those are probably the major categories of avian emergencies that we see. Not just taking a nap. He's really, really sick. He's at the hospital and he's keeping his head down, eyes closed, and coming here and I'm stretching and he barely responds.
We always say if you're going to call me and ask a question, then you should probably already be calling your vet. That's how serious. I mean, we've had some emergencies here, and the only reason that they made it is because the second we saw that the littlest thing was off, we were already on the phone begging her to get us in.
And it's better safe than sorry. Sometimes it's like, oh, look at the wizard, can you get the mom? But especially for respiratory distress, that's just like the worst thing ever. Okay, you get to play with poop. I love playing with bird poop because it's a way to learn a lot about bird without even having to touch it. It's awesome. It's like a hands-off diagnostic. And most of the diagnostics we do with poop are pretty inexpensive. So the droppings in birds, they don't have a urinary bladder. Birds don't have a bladder. So when they poop, it all comes out at once. There's three major components to the dropping. There's the fecal material, so feces, which is coming from the bowel, and it's usually normally green or brown. And then the urates are a crystalline white or cream-colored material in the droppings. And then there's a little bit of urine. So there's three parts. So the urine and the urates come from the kidneys, and then the feces comes from the GI tract, the bowel. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So good-looking poop there, right? Okay. So we're going to talk a little bit about, let me talk about those. I recommend using on the bottom of the cage newspaper or paper of some kind. A lot of folks like corn cob, but there's a couple problems with corn cob. Can you think of the problems with corn cob? Yeah, like where's the poop? Like, if your bird had a problem that we could have identified by looking at the poop, you'd miss it. Because here's a little poop, here's a little poop, but I mean, they quickly get buried in the droppings. Not the worst case if you have a healthy bird, but you might miss something. Also, if it gets wet, it gets moldy, and that mold is bad for birds. So I just recommend, I mean, it looks nice. That's probably not cheap either. Corn cob, or is it cheap? I don't know. I don't want to know that. But I recommend it. Okay, color changes. What's wrong with this poop?
He ate blueberries.
So what's different about this dropping?
It's blue.
Color. what's got the color difference? What part of the
urine?
Yeah, so the urine has, what color is the urine?
Blue.
Yeah, so what color is the feces?
Green.
Pretty blue. What color is the urine? Yeah, so, blueberry? Is it blueberry?
Blackberries.
Blackberries? Yeah. This is just colored colors. This is that bird's exact diet. So this bird loves to pick out the blue pellets on that. And I don't want to get called about if the bird just eats the red ones. Yeah, that happens a lot. Oh my god, my bird's eating me! What do you feed them? So absolutely, color in, color out. So if they like the red ones, they'll turn red, and then we'll look sometimes like blood. So we can look under the microscope or do a quick blood test, a cold blood test. That can also help us out, too. Or you can just take those things out of the diaper line and see if it clears up if the bird's otherwise healthy. What about this? Is this from? This is, yeah. You're on your way to the AV vet if you see that. What, can you think of any diseases that could be associated with that?
Lower GI disease.
Lower GI disease, yeah. So it's down here somewhere. Because this is blood, too. This black. Here, that's called melanin, and so that's high up, and it's been digested with stomach acids, and it turns black, and that's called melanin. That's still blood, just higher up. So things like egg binding, tumors, cancer, but also lead poisoning. When avian vet sees blood in the droppings, we're also thinking lead poisoning as well. I think that's what this bird had, and this bird didn't make it. So, a lot of people say my bird has diarrhea. We call this diarrhea. And so, if the dropping is loose and watery, that may not be diarrhea. This is actually polyuria. Polyuria is increased urine. So, the feces looks pretty normal. It still has that little tube of toothpaste left to it, right? It's holding its shape. It's just, see all this rim here. It's all... clear rim, that's all urine. So that is polyuria. So we have feces, which is pretty normal. It's sort of spread out because of all the urine. So it's not holding its nice tight shape.
the urates look normal, but then all of this is urine. This is not diarrhea. This is increased urine that's coming from the kidneys. And that could be, can you guys think of any reason why a bird would be polyuria? Yes. Probably some of you have worked with me on your birds on this.
Hormone.
Yeah. And high estrogen will, it's called the phosphate flush. It'll try to flush out phosphorus and they'll get watery droppings. So a hormone imbalance, diabetes will do this in birds. Yes, birds get diabetes. Other hormone imbalances, and then other endocrine disturbances like pituitary disease, that sort of thing. This is diarrhea, and I know it's not a great picture, but it's pretty much the only one I have. This is from a eclectus parrot that had a lower GI infection, and it just has all this splatter. This is all feces. There's some urines in there, but it's all just splattery, and it's lost its consistency. So the fecal material has lost its consistency. That's diarrhea. It stinks, too. It smells real bad, so I know exactly what that smells like. This is maldigestion. This bird is passing whole seeds and then droppings. Not normal. Now sometimes you'll think it is if it landed in a pile of seeds at the bottom of the cage, but this bird's actually passing this material and its droppings. Do you think of anything that might cause that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, PVD. Which is that? Yeah. Okay.
I read it then.
Okay. Yeah, so anything that causes the bowel, the GI tract not to work properly, especially the stomach. So ganglionitis.
Do you talk about PDD to explain what that is?
PDD is short for proventricular dilatation disease, which is a disease where the nerves to the GI tract, especially the stomach, are wiped out by inflammation. And then the stomach doesn't work properly after that. So they can get a stretched out stomach, they can crop, they can throw up, lose weight, have some digestive droppings. And it is associated with a Borna virus, Avian Borna virus, which there is mounting evidence that it spread from the mother to the chick, Mike's mom. But it's also directly contagious between birds. But it may be that many of the birds that we see actually got it from their mother. And they can lay dormant for years, decades even. I've seen 20, 30 year old birds that lived alone their whole lives that had this as a diagnosis. So it's overdiagnosed. It can be managed. It's widely believed to be ultimately fatal. There are reports of birds that seem to get dramatically better and even be able to stay off medications, but it's a really bad disease. And it can affect other neurologic tissues as well, so the brain, spinal cord, our heart conduction system, adrenal glands, so bad disease. There's no simple, we need to test for Borna virus, but it's like HIV/AIDS. They can be virus positive, disease negative, they can be disease positive, virus negative, it's not really sure, it's very complicated. It's the subject of a 2-hour lecture, so. But this is not the best coloring, but if the urates are the color of the screen, then that's bad, and that usually means they're passing bile pigments in their kidneys, which usually means they have bad liver disease, which could also be a sign of like acute liver failure, lead poisoning, and that sort of thing. And that sometimes, if they haven't eaten for a while, like overnight, they're going to pass bile, which is normal. But normal, the bile from their liver gets blended in with their food as it's being processed and moving through, so you don't see that pigment. But if overnight or whatever, if they're sick, then they don't have that food in there to dilute that color down. So when they pass it, they just pass in this dark green material, which is the bile. And that is a strong pigment, and it can actually leach into the urine and urates and make it look like there's a problem, but it can be normal. Not normal, but it doesn't always mean liver failure. This is a bird that threw up, but it got carsick on its way to us. Birds oftentimes get carsick when they come to see us. They know they're coming to see me, but they get carsick. They will throw up sometimes. But another thing that will happen with birds, and especially with little parakeets, if they throw up, they sling their Was that? So, for say Americana, and so the cultivars that we often have consumed here are the Haas and the Forte. Haas are probably the most common, but both of them have the toxin, which is person. So person is the R engineer of person, the major toxic component. Somebody
Feather is abnormal. That's not the case. It's actually a natural growth process of the feather.
feathers, but you don't know which feather is bleeding. In this case, this is a cockatiel. It's the right wing, and it's from the outer trimeres, and it's broken right at the base of the feather here, the blood here. What I do is I try to let these feathers, and I know this sounds cruel and unusual because I am, I might sometimes wet these feathers a little bit with rubbing alcohol, and I try to stay away from there, I do, but so there's a lot of oils, natural oils on the feathers. I just try to wet them with water, it ain't gonna work, but if you use rubbing alcohol, that will soak the feathers and help get it out of the way so we can steam this a little bit better. So I try to identify where the bleeding is coming from, and if there's a little bit of that feather shaft sticking out of the follicle, I'll grab it with needle nose pliers or hemostat, and I'll pull in this direction. I'll support the wing up here, and I'll pull in this direction. And so here's the shaft of the feather. It needs to have a rounded end like that, because that's what the base of the feather looks like. It shouldn't look all jagged like it does here. It should be rounded. That means you got the feather successfully out. But sometimes it will continue to bleed from that follicle, so we'll put a little bit of pressure on there to try to control that bleeding for a little bit of time. If you can't get to the avian vet, and the bird is actively hemorrhaging, you can try to put pressure on it. You can try to use cornstarch or flour. Stipic powder, it can be a little bit caustic, but it can save lives. We do still recommend trying to stop the bleeding and keep the bird quiet. You can stop the bleeding, it's not an emergency. But sometimes if the bird's flapping and stuff like that, the bleeding will start back up again. It's much better if an avian vet pulls this out than you, because you may really cause harm. You might pull out the wrong feather, you might break the wing, you might rip the inside of the follicle, which is like tissue, and it may become permanently damaged. So if you can help it, I would definitely recommend trying to get them to the vet. You see a lot of birds that have been attacked by other animals in the house or not in the house. So dogs, cats. If you know or suspect that your bird was bitten or scratched by a cat, you need to get it to the vet right away. Because there are bacteria in the cat's saliva that they can lick their claws, and so a scratch can do it too. If a little puncture and those bacteria get under the skin, that bird's in trouble. Those bacteria can grow and cause a septic problem, and that bird can be dead within 2 or 3 days. And I usually say by the time they come in, it's oftentimes too late. You know, they've been so bad that I've seen blood. I've seen bacteria in the blood on a bloodstream. I can see them in the microscope. So it's better safe than sorry if the bird to the vet. You think that a cat scratched or bit it. You guys have any idea what attacked this gray parrot? Look at all that. Look at all those all over the butt. Is that the same bird? It is the same bird, yes. This is the head shot, this is the butt shot. Scratches. Yeah, that's a jugular catheter. That's a intravenous catheter and a jugular
catheter. Did he survive?
Yeah. He lived!
Doesn't make it right, but he lived.
Oh my God. So the question is, how did he get together with the squirrel?
I think it was a screen in porch, I think. The bird was out there. So it must have been a crazed squirrel. That's what they said. Multiple bites.
Looks like a Cooper's hawk, isn't that?
Ceiling fans and birds don't miss. And you know, if you have ceiling fans, keep them off. You know, somebody can turn them on back so that the bird can get out. See that a lot. We just had a case last week where a bird was sun caught there. It failed the ceiling fans on full speed. It hit the ceiling fan and it whacked it into a door and then it fell from the door. It was amazing how well it actually. Doors, so birds can get climbed in doors, you know, if they're perched on top of it and you don't realize it's there, they can get their toes broken or worse. Windows, birds can fly into windows, mirrors, other
would you pick a black parrot? Says a lot about them.
That wraps it up. That was a little bit.
That's Piccolo. No, it's she's not here.
This is an emergency. I saw on July 4th one day. I was a really having a bad day because July 4th is a holiday and I've seen emergency and bird is sick. Then the bird pooped and it's fine.
Thank you so much.